Hey friends, you know the aggregations feature for Power BI enables interactive analysis over big data in a way that was not possible before. And now you can unlock petabyte scale datasets for clicky, draggy, droppy, timey-wimey data analysis, which is insane. And Christian is here to show us how to dramatically reduce the cost of unlocking big datasets in Azure today on Azure Friday. Hey folks, I'm Scott Hanselman, and it is another episode of Azure Friday. I'm here with Christian Wade, and we're going to talk about big data.
Absolutely.
How big?
I'm talking massive.
Okay, like massive, like
even bigger than that.
Bigger than
like
that.
I'm talking huge.
Bigger than this? Actually,
even bigger than all three of those combined.
All three of these combined. Okay, well, this is about a megabyte. You told me you're talking about petabytes.
Yes, petabytes. This is a difficult concept to allow our minds to actually fathom. We have to kind of expand our minds. We're actually talking about in the petabyte scale is what we're dealing with here. This is absolutely on another planet to anything we've seen before for interactive analysis.
Wow. And what I'm having trouble getting my head around is that you said we're going to be doing clicky, clicky, draggy, droppy, which doesn't parse with petabyte. Like I think of big data, I figure there must be a query language or something complicated I have to
yes.
do. And now you are saying I can go and click and drag and drop.
That's the beauty of it. We, as a user, you can be a completely non-technical user. Mm-hmm. You don't need to learn Spark SQL. You don't need to have consultants build reports for you. You can just immediately immerse yourself in the data and just clicky, clicky, draggy, droppy, interactively create reports on the fly over petabyte scale data sets. And guess what? It's relatively very, very cheap compared to anything that we've had before.
Seriously, so there's just no limits.
I mean, the limits are, you know, on another planet.
Right.
They're on a completely different planet.
I tried to ask the computer how many megabytes a petabyte was, and it gave it to me in scientific notation because it didn't have enough zeros.
Yeah.
So blow me away. What do you got?
All right. Okay. So I'm going to start with this data set, and this data set is data for a crowdsourced courier service
okay.
where a smartphone app emits the driver's locations, and it generates a ton of data. So here we have the location count measure, which as you can see is simply the count of all the rows in the table.
Hmm.
Looks completely normal.
All right.
So I'm gonna casually drag this onto the canvas and find out how many rows we have in this thing. Now, just to put this in context for you, Scott.
All right.
First time I came here about a year and a half, it was a big deal for me. I was on Azure Friday and I was getting to show off 2 billion rows
okay.
of data. Right?
Yeah.
And then I came back and I said, Scott, you know what? I'm pushing the boundaries even further. I'm up to 10 billion rows of data. I had a 400 gigabyte Azure Analysis Services server with over 25 cores, and I was pushing the boundaries of what was done before.
Mm-hmm.
Well, guess how many rows we have in here? Let
okay.
me show you. We actually have a trillion. We've pushed beyond a trillion rows of
That's
data.
A thousand billion or a million million?
Exactly. Yeah, I'll take your word for it because it's on a level that is beyond anything that we've had before. This is actually a quarter of a petabyte. This
wow.
is a quarter of a petabyte right here
wow.
from HDI coming through from HDI Spark. Yeah, absolutely on another planet. We've
okay.
just blown the laws of physics out of the water. We just brushed the laws
and
of physics.
And I noticed that there wasn't a pause.
There was no pause. It was instant. This is instant gratification. Let me show you how responsive this is. We have, let's go with, say, distance traveled, and we'll break it out by date, and we can just make it nice and big. We can make it a bar chart. We can break it out by the miles per job, and we just get instant response times over a quarter of a petabyte of data, right? It's just clicky, clicky,
so
draggy, drop it down and analysis.
How is that possible? Is it pre-chewed on the right indexes? I mean, back in the day, 20 years ago, I would have to, even to do a table scan, I'd have to think about indexes and clustered indexes and all that kind of stuff
exactly.
from a SQL Server perspective.
Exactly.
It's
so
thinking
how is
about
this,
it's the dimensionality of the
exactly.
data.
Exactly. How is this physically possible? So let's address that. So the way that we achieve this blazing fast performance in Power BI is that we cache the data into memory, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now, for these large scale data sets, you need a lot of memories. Hence, Azure Analysis Services has these 400 gigabyte SKUs.
Mm-hmm.
So what we're actually doing here is We're still caching the data into memory, but we're doing it at the aggregated level, which uses a tiny fraction of the memory requirements and unlocks these massive data sets in a way that was physically impossible before. Mm-hmm. And the resource usage is tiny, and we're unlocking these massive data sets. Because the thing about it is that business intelligence queries, probably 95% or above, are at the aggregated level. So you're going to get very high cache hit rates. Mm. And then if the user happens to drill down to the detail level, it's okay. It just submits a direct query to the source, which I'll demonstrate in just a second.
Yeah, that was my question. What percentage of these am I going to be, cache hits?
Yes.
And which one of them is going to mean I have to go to lunch?
Yes.
And come back?
So let me show you. So let's say we want to filter this, I think, by December 23rd. And I'm going to break out the location count. And I'll make it a table.
And you're still talking about 21 million records at this point, even though you filtered down to a single day.
Exactly, to a single day and a single. And this is only the jobs for the were over 50 miles for drivers who subsequently left the company.
Right? Oh wow!
Because this app emits the location, literally every few seconds, so it just generates a ton of data. And now I'm going to break out the driver name.
Okay. Right.
So I've interactively, over a quarter of a petabyte of data, I have generated a report of drivers who left the company who worked on December 23rd and performed jobs of over 50 miles, right? Just instant, right? And all this time we've been hitting the in-memory cache because there's some level of aggregation.
Right.
I'm now going to drill down and I'm going to maybe look at Abigail Johnson. So I'm going to drill through to this movements report that's going to actually plot the individual locations for Abigail Johnson on December 23rd.
Right, and the reason that there's such a huge amount of data here is we're talking about latitudes and longitude over time.
Over time,
so it's the clickstream data equivalent of driving around or moving around.
Exactly. So we're now going to be at the detail level where we will have points for each row in the trillion row table. So it's not hitting the aggregation, hence it's a little bit slower.
So it's digging into the join of, you find a single user out of a trillion, and now you're bringing together for a single day all of her movements.
Exactly.
I'm imagining the query I'd have to write, and it took, 10 seconds?
And it's already done, and if I show you here, this is a 23-node HDI Spark cluster.
Okay.
So this just completed. There's the filter for Abigail Johnson. And now we can see that Abigail Johnson had to drive all the way across Memphis. This was the day just before the holidays. She was looking forward to spending time with her family. She got frustrated. She left the company, and maybe she started her own crowdsourcing company, and she's doing very well now. But the point being, we've unlocked a quarter of a petabyte of data in a way that was physically impossible before, using a tiny fraction of the resources. And if the user drills down to the detail level where there is no cache, that's okay. It just submits a direct query to the source. The source can be, in this case, HDI Spark. It can be Databricks. It can be Azure SQL Data Warehouse. Mm-hmm. And these source systems, they tend to handle these non-aggregated filtered queries very well.
Because they're targeted.
Exactly. They're targeted. And the aggregated queries is really what Power BI does really well. So it gives you this balanced architecture where you can spread the load of your queries across the architecture and really get efficient usage.
Yeah, it's interesting because you're seeing a separation of concerns about each back-end data store doing what it does best, but the front end is presenting it in such a way that it's seamless and the business user is not thinking about picking a back end.
Absolutely. So they can just have this single reusable semantic model in an enterprise organization. And if they happen to drill down to the detail level where there is no cache, that's okay. It still works. And it unlocks these massive data sets in a way that was physically impossible before. And another point is that you don't actually need a trillion rows to use this, right? Mm-hmm. You can just be in the range that you would have needed an Azure Analysis Services, 100 gigabytes or 400 gigabyte server, and you had to do a lot of data duplication and management overhead to refresh these caches, whereas now you can refresh them very quickly, very easily, make the data available for the users much quicker and much more cheaply.
So some of the people who are watching might be thinking, well, I don't have a petabyte of data. I only have a couple hundred million rows.
Yeah.
They're welcome as well, certainly.
They are absolutely welcome, and they will benefit a lot, absolutely. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Was this hard to set up? Did you have to do anything to warn it about aggregates?
This is actually funnily enough, probably the simplest scalability we've delivered in Microsoft BI. I mean, this is absolutely very, very simple. So in fact, I'm going to explain it conceptually using these slides. So, and I'll just move this out of the, okay. So traditionally, you would have to choose whether the Power BI model was import or direct query, and it was a binary decision. So the whole model, all of the tables had to be imported, and you'd get that blazing fast performance.
Right.
But if you had this really big data set, it could be expensive and time consuming to generate that import cached in-memory data set. So you could set it up for direct query, where Power BI will dynamically submit queries to the source on the fly, like we saw against HDI Spark. But then all of the tables had to be direct query, which meant that for a big model, it tended to be slow, right? So what we're doing now is we are bringing together the best of both worlds so that in a single model, we can, at the table level, choose whether it's direct query or import, which gives much more flexibility. So basically, where traditionally you'd have to pick the whole model as direct query or import, you can now pick and choose which individual tables to cache where it really counts, right?
How would I know that until I've done some of these queries? Does this require some planning and some forethought about the shape of the data and how my business users will look at it?
Potentially a little bit. We are introducing some capabilities to automatically suggest the tables which get queried most based off the logs. But business intelligence modelers would generally have a good feel. You could say, well, these tables are for my executive dashboard and they need to be super fast, right? So in this particular case, let's say the sales table has 10 billion rows and doesn't need to be a trillion. It could be 10 billion, for example, and it could be quite expensive and time consuming to cache. So what we can do is we can create an aggregated table that is going to be the sum of sales grouped by date ID, geography ID. And if you think about this, this is going to go from 10 billion to potentially thousands of rows. It's just going to be the cross join of date ID and geography ID, which is going to be tiny. You can refresh that into memory very, very quickly using a tiny fraction of the memory. And then you set up the mappings so that queries that are submitted, so as the users interact with the visuals in Power BI, it submits queries to the data set. And as queries are submitted, you'll see that this query is just asking for sum of sales amount. It doesn't know anything about the aggregation table. The users, the consumers, they know nothing about this. And even the queries don't need to know anything about the aggregation table. It's completely abstracted from the consumer. But then the query comes in and it just says, I want sum of sales. And internally, the engine will redirect that query to the aggregation table, knowing that this query is at the granularity that can hit the cache. Right?
And how fresh are these things? If I'm thinking about the amount of chewing and work that has to be done to cache this, is it happening on a schedule? Do I have to give a freshness indicator?
Yes, so you can schedule it, and it will be much fresher than trying to cache the whole table, because the whole table would take a lot longer to cache. So you could potentially refresh this, you know, in seconds, potentially, depending.
Because executives always say that they want real-time data, but we all realize that real-time might be every 15, 20 minutes.
Yes,
it doesn't necessarily mean every second.
So that's another feature, is that it unlocks that data freshness and that near real-time capability. Being able to pick and choose which tables to cache and not to cache opens up all of those scenarios as well.
Wow.
Absolutely, yeah. So then a query comes in that, again, just asks for sum of sales amount. It doesn't know anything about the sales aggregation table, but in this case, it's grouping by customer name. Customer attributes cannot hit the aggregation table because for a particular geography, there'll be multiple customers. It wouldn't know which one to aggregate to. So it now, on the fly, internally, reverts to direct query and then submits the query to the source like we saw in the demo. That is basically it. It's so simple and so powerful.
Why didn't we do this 20 years ago?
We did some other versions of this before, but nothing worked as simply and as beautifully as this.
Okay, so when is this available? Do I have this now? Do I have to sign up for something?
All you have to do is download the September Power BI desktop release. And it is there. It's available. It is released for the masses. It is ready to use.
Fantastic. All right. We are learning all about petabytes of data and how to unlock that power here on Azure Friday.